Thank you. I thank the organizers of the meeting of disease modeling and public health to incorporate the topic of food as an essential part of public health, and for the invitation, Martin in particular. I am at IIIT, Indraprastha Institute of Information Technology at Delhi, as part of Center for Computational Biology, and I'll be telling you about something very, very exciting and interesting that we are conducting, doing for the last 5 years as part of my lab, and we have named it Computational Gastronomy. And I wouldn't blame you if you have not heard this term, because it wasn't there earlier. The topic is of looking at food from a data perspective so as to come up with data-driven innovations. Well, that's the idea behind it. Very briefly, I have an identity crisis. I started as a physicist, then into computer science, then into computational biology. I'm happy my PhD thesis supervisor here, Sumdatta, in the audience, where I was in CCMB, worked in computational biology, and had a trajectory of modeling protein structures using graph theoretical paradigm, then disease modeling, even brain network modeling at NCBS, and all the way up to here at IIIT Delhi. And in this whole process, I must tell you that this is a serendipitous theme of work that we have started working on. This is a decade-old institution, right? I hope you got the binary joke. A very new one and completely devoted to computer science and allied areas, computational biology being one of them. My lab is complex systems laboratory, and we look at a variety of complex systems largely from biological domain, starting from nano-level structures, that of protein structures, to micrometer level where you have molecular interactomes, to all the way up to food. In a way, it is a complex system. That's the way I have been looking at it for a while. I personally look at complex systems in a manner that they are composed of large number of discrete elements which are interacting with each other in a subtle manner, giving rise to emergent phenomena. The sum of the parts is not the same as the whole. And these are the various models that we have looked at, investigated, and food being the recent addition to this. While doing so, I have been using this approach of looking at these interesting complex systems from the perspective of A, understanding them, to model them using varieties of mathematical as well as computational framework, finding ways of controlling them whenever possible, not that it has always been easy, and a larger viewpoint is that of learning from biological systems such that hopefully we can design engineer systems which are robust as biological systems tend to be. And at the core of the whole research, the philosophy has been to ask hypothesis-driven questions, build mostly secondary data structures wherever necessary, and hopefully come up with applications whenever we can make it. So computational gastronomy looks at various aspects of food, whether it is culture or it is recipes, coming down to recipes, ingredient, nutrition, taste part of it, as well as finally the health part of it, which is rather critical and important from the point of view of this meeting. So what I intend to do is to give you an overview, starting with a small story where the whole thing began, and tell you about where do we stand today. And I look forward to your comments, criticism, and inputs, hopefully collaborations who can possibly join hands with us. We define computational gastronomy as a data science which blends food data with computation. The idea is to gather data of different aspects of the food so as to create an integrated resource and then ask interesting questions, design algorithms for specific purposes. I shall mention what are those specific objectives towards which we are working. When we look at food, I started looking, as opposed to a typical food scientist, food from a cultural perspective. Because what we eat on a day-to-day basis are traditional recipes, like we had breakfast today in the morning, right? All of these recipes have taken their own time, and they have been shaped over a long time, of the order of maybe 10,000 odd years of the human history, and we have arrived at the recipes that we have today. So I look at it, food, as a magical phenomena, something which transforms raw ingredients by application of variety of processes into a delicious recipe. Incidentally, the human brain, the disproportionately large human brain that we have, and all the creativity that we can, and all other abilities, that cognitive abilities that we attach with the brain, has been argued to be partly contributed by the discovery of cooking itself, because we were left out enough time from foraging and easy access to calories, because of which brain size could increase. And that's the argument which is made in this book called Catching Fire, which essentially says that cooking was one of the major factors that was critical for development of disproportionately large brain size. Ironically, it seems that over the period of evolution, we have also come to a stage where food, while being very critical for what we are today, is also become a very important problem which is plaguing us thanks to all kind of lifestyle disorders that we are facing because of the way we eat what we eat. So diet is a very, very critical component, and we need to address it. We need to understand it from a cultural perspective, is the view that I take. And incidentally, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal includes food as one of the key component, again, ironically, from two different perspectives. In terms of one, that of making sure that there is no hunger, but at the same time also probably saving us from overnutrition, which is what is possibly causing some of the problems that we are talking about today. While this seems like a policy problem, we started with by asking a very, very simple and curious question that anybody might want to ask. And that was, why do we eat what we eat? If I had a bread pakoda today in the breakfast, which many of you did have, or some other dish today, why is it that I'm eating that today? So I could have a proximate answer in terms of, because that's available to me, that's what was given to me, etc. Or you could keep looking for ultimate answers, where you could have reasons why we end up eating these recipes that we eat today. And a very interesting question, I must say, it's a gastronomical question. We realized that this is a very deep question and rather difficult one to answer. So we modified it slightly by looking at a recipe in a very simplistic manner. So like a typical physicist, I'm looking at a recipe like a spherical cow. So I am assuming, to begin with, this is circa 2014-15, a recipe is an unordered list of ingredients. Ah, well, that's not true. All the chefs that I've got to know by now would say that, come down, Professor Bagler, to my kitchen and I will give you an unordered list of ingredients. So that's not going to happen, right? But nonetheless, let's begin here. So we have ingredients that are going into each of these recipes. And the question that we asked, as opposed to asking why do we eat what we eat, was why do we combine ingredients the way we do in our traditional recipes? Because essentially, given the basket of various ingredients that we have, that of vegetables, spices, lentils, and all others, recipes are predominantly a creative art of putting ingredients in a manner that they are palatable, hopefully delicious. That's where it goes. So anybody can think of an answer for this particular question about why do we combine ingredients the way we do? Well, looks like a challenging question, and therefore an expert chef came up with an hypothesis. Heston Blumenthal, my UK colleagues would have heard about him, the fat duck restaurant. So he proposed this notion that ingredients that are very similar to each other in terms of their taste and odor tend to go well with each other, right? Well, that was the proposition that he made, essentially speaking that if you could somehow, in an abstract manner, characterize an ingredient and then look at what is the overlap between them, we would be able to tell whether they will go together well or not. Well, that was the proposition that he came, and incidentally, it was shown in 2011 paper that indeed, when you look at recipes, ingredients, with the flavor basis in it, turns out that there is something called pairing of ingredients happening, and the principle being largely true. What we did when I started this journey in a classroom while teaching a course on complex networks, when I was still at IIT Jodhpur, was that of asking this question in the context of Indian cuisine, which was sorely missing in the previous analysis that was done. I had a hunch, and probably two possible ways it could have gone. One is that the hypothesis is true, and a physicist in me would be satisfied thinking that I have confirmed a generic rule that might be possibly true about the recipes. But the other possibility could have been that I would have found something different out of it, thereby breaking the rule. Both the possibilities were exciting enough to begin with. So we started by looking at Indian recipes, and all of you appreciate that India is a very, very diverse and heterogeneous nation with varieties of cultures and culinary practices. So we compiled recipes, 2,500 odd recipes at that time, from length and the breadth of the countries belonging to different regions, their geocultural regions, communities, and cultures. And looked at these recipes from these regions at the level of the ingredients that they have in it, unordered list of ingredients, as of now still spherical cow, and each of the ingredient is exclusively marked to one of these categories, a dairy or a spice or a vegetable or some such, 16 odd categories that we have. Well, the reason why ingredients have been chosen into these recipes is primarily because of the taste and the odor of the ingredients, although other factors do play a role, the texture, smoothness, roughness, color, etc. It seems that these are two predominant factors which, by interacting with the molecular machinery, the olfactory and gustatory machinery, are responsible for we choosing them or not choosing them to be used in recipes. So we collected the information that is at the underlying information, that of flavor molecules. So I'm making an assumption that an ingredient is a sum total of its flavor molecules. Again, another simplification, because not all of these molecules are present in equal quantity in these ingredients, nor each one of them is equally potent in terms of triggering the sensory mechanisms. And moreover, not to mention, they might be interacting with each other to give rise to some synergistic effect, but we are ignoring it for the moment. So we compiled the flavor profiles of these ingredients, and now we have a possible way of quantifying the food pairing that was proposed by the chef and checking whether it works or not. So now this is the cuisine we have, and all of these are recipes, the dish, each one of them. If you were to dissect one of these recipe and look at what are the ingredients present in it, in this caricature recipe, I'm showing you four ingredients. And if you were to look at all pairs of ingredients, quite clearly there'll be NC2 pairs, given n number of ingredients in a recipe. All we are doing is to ask this question that in all each of these pair, if I look at the flavor set of flavor molecules in onion and that of in the coconut, how many of them are common? The idea being that more the number of common molecules, more is the similarity between them. Now, it's an we are making an assumption, but that seems to be a reasonable assumption to begin with. All right. Having said that, if the cuisines that we have, had they been random bunch of ingredients, which is what I would make, not being a chef, and randomly putting them together, I metaphorically call it as a monkey cuisine, having given the basket of ingredients and penchant of putting things together and cooking them, a monkey would actually end up putting them randomly together. This is a random control of recipes. Turns out that there will be some amount of food pairing or shared molecules. Well, that is where it stands, the random cuisine. What we had seen earlier was that many of the Western cuisines, the Latin American, Northern American, Eastern European, and Southern European cuisines, tend to have a higher amount of sharing among their ingredients, suggesting that there is a uniform blend of ingredients in the recipes from these cuisines. Interestingly, what we found with the recipes that we had compiled at that time from Tarla Dalal is that, interestingly, that these have a contrasting blend of ingredients. A typical recipe from Indian cuisine will tend to have less and less shared molecules, a potpourri of flavors in a typical recipe as opposed to a typical Western recipe. It's a statistical observation nonetheless. You will have exceptions all the time. All right? So, well, that was a very, very interesting observation to make for us. And, this is the summary of it, that the Western cuisines seem to have uniform blend of ingredients, whereas the recipes that we had investigated at that time, we figured out that they tend to have a contrasting blend of ingredients. An interesting experiment that we did is to, this is a way of characterizing a cuisine and understanding what populations tend to eat on a day-to-day basis by virtue of being locked into the cultural practices, right? So we asked a question that, given that food pairing is a quantifiable, measurable parameter of recipes in a cuisine, are there specific ingredients of certain category which might be rather critical for the observed food pairing? For that reason, what we did is to look at the food pairing observed in the Indian cuisine that we had collected at that time and said, okay, let's say everything else being the same, if I were to shuffle ingredients of one category, say for example vegetables, and I were to randomly take a vegetable and put some other vegetable, wherever there is a vegetable in the recipe, all other ingredients of the category remaining the same, what would happen to the food pairing? Now, answering this question gastronomically would be difficult in terms of figuring out how it tastes, etc., but measuring with the parameter that we have defined is easy. We did that, and we figured that most of the categories, when we shuffle within intra-category shuffling, when we do that, the food pairing index, I'm not talking about taste at the moment yet, changes marginally. But for one category, if we were to do intra-category shuffling, looks like the food pairing in Indian cuisine gets drastically modified. And if you can guess this particular category of the ingredients, what that would be. Many of you actually guessed it, I heard you, and these are actually spices and herbs, right? Turns out that if you were to shuffle spices, turns out the food pairing jumps quite a lot and you know becomes more like a monkey cuisine, right? Suggesting that spices and herbs are the fulcrum of Indian cuisine, right? It's like essentially the molecule actually specific nature of the Indian cuisine. Still, we are not touching the taste part of it. It's a far more complex problem, all right? And we took a spoof on a popular Indian brand to say that it's a spice which is the taste of India. What we realized is that food pairing is a far simple parameter to be measured when given the complexity of the cuisine. So what we came up with, what we call as now, culinary fingerprints. These are fingerprints, these are patterns which are measured at the level of recipe, ingredients, flavor molecules. To an extent, we have gone all the level up to the functional groups in these flavor molecules to see what kind of characteristic features they have. Without getting into the details of it, I can show you that this is more like a pattern that you find in a specific cuisine, like a South Indian cuisine vis-a-vis other cuisine, suggesting which category of ingredients are contributing to what extent, either towards contrasting blend or towards uniform blend. Well, that kind of characterizes a cuisine. So we're essentially treating a cuisine as a living thing. And like a DNA fingerprinting, we're trying to find out what is so idiosyncratic about this cuisine in terms of the patterns that we measure in them. So we ended up coming up with this notion of culinary fingerprints, the details of which I suggest you to do definitely look up and read on our papers that we have published. Notice that all that we have done so far ended up looking into the taste part of it, right? And of course, we are here to discuss about the health part of it. So I'll tell you about what are the different ways by which we are trying to make efforts such that food can be made more nutritious and healthier. This particular research in 2015 was identified as the emerging technology in MIT Tech Review, and was also I realized after doing a lot of work in systems biology, network biology, I was hopeful of making contributions in the area of drug discovery, which I couldn't do much. I realized all of a sudden I have serendipitously touched a topic which seems to be having a huge consequences for public health, human health, as well as taste, not to mention that, right? So this is how it was highlighted, saying that you're sitting on the sweet spot predominantly because we are looking at food, data, and computation together, right? So what I will now do in the remainder of the time is to give you a summary of what we did after that. It's been 5 years that we started on this topic, and I've been dedicated to work on different angles of food and gastronomy by using data-driven analysis. That's a predominant core theme that we are using. I shall first tell you about molecular level, what we have done, the flavor molecular level. Then I'll tell you about what are we doing at the level of culture, recipes, and various cooking protocols that go into cooking. And finally, I'll tell you about the health part of it. One of the most important thing that I realize is that all of this science is more like 19th century physics, that it's early, or maybe 17th century physics. A lot of interesting and exciting questions to ask, and not much framework has been set in place here. And if you want to make it a data-driven science, you need to have quality curated data available. So the data of recipes and the flavor molecules that we used and others started using after us have been very primitive. So one of the tasks that I took up was to compiling the data of flavor molecules in all natural ingredients. This was a gigantic task in terms of compiling all of this from various literature, including some biblical books on flavor molecules. What we did was to pull up all of these ingredients. There are around 1,000 ingredients and to the tune of around 2,500 flavor molecules which are reported to be present in them, as well as these flavor molecules at molecular level have been reported to be having certain odor and taste. All of these have been reported and put together in this database called FlavorDB, and this is the flavor man, if you wish. And it has got variety of attributes, as I said, at the level of ingredients, what sources do they come from, what categories do they have, molecules, their sensory percepts, tentative, putatively identified receptors present in them, and other details which are critical for the flavor molecule. While I was doing so, I was heavily getting connected with chefs, the magicians who are creating this alchemy of cooking, and not to mention even day-to-day basis, anybody who cooks at home. So I was getting connected with them, and I realized that these guys would need something to play with And while they were appreciating our science, they needed something easy to deal with. So we converted this database into a mobile app. So it's an Android app. You can download from the Play Store and play with it. This has got all the information that I had mentioned to you earlier. This was released at World Heritage and Cuisine Summit and very much appreciated by the chefs. Having collected a large amount of these flavor and taste molecules, we were trying to look at using ways of machine learning and big data techniques for finding better food. Well, that was the objective that we are working. One specific theme that we have worked on and have recently published this work is that of predicting taste. While people had been looking at individually predicting bitter and sweetness from molecular properties, what we did was to treat this interesting axis of bittersweet as a dichotomic axis, wherein we like sweetness. Evolutionarily speaking, we are ingrained to like sweetness because of the nutritious thing that we end up getting from the natural ingredients. At the same time, we tend to deter bitterness, dislike bitterness because of known properties which are not good for us, poisonous at times. But at the same time, what the idea was, can we predict the bitter and sweet taste having got enough amount of data which is labeled? That's what we did by compiling a huge amount of data. And as opposed to the previous researchers who had refrained from publishing data as well as models, on GitHub we have made this data completely available along with the models and a desktop installable software. And I'm sure that this will be of value to the flavor companies as well as researchers who are wanting to work on. So this is called Bittersweet, recently published in Scientific Reports. And the next direction that we are looking at, again, a known problem, but we are trying to expand the scope of it, that of predicting sweetness. And how does it relate to public health? One of the key way it goes in is that sugar is considered to be one major bane when it comes to public health, obesity, and even diabetes. So the question here is that, can we find nature-like molecules which have desirable sweetness, but at the same time don't add to the calories, thereby leading to the problem of diabetes and obesity? That's a direction that we are looking at. And this was at the level of molecules. And at the level of recipes, another problem of data was that of where is the data of recipes? Again, huge number of recipes are known and they're locked into the local cultures, in households, communities, etc. And not much is available openly. So what we did is to start compiling these recipes at the moment from online repertoires, as well as some offline repertoires like books, etc., that are available. What we did is to compile. Right now we have to the tune of 160,000 recipes, which are belonging to 24 different geocultural regions, which are shown here, and approximately 72 countries to which they can be labeled to. So this is geocultural mapping of the recipes. And of course, we have the flavor molecules from each of these ingredients which are going into the recipes as exhaustively as that can be made. Now, we have done the culinary fingerprinting of the whole world cuisines and have got interesting features that are coming out of it. Well, this is of academic curiosity of trying to figure out what are these cuisines, how are they related to each other, are there practices that they have adopted from each other in the process of migration and colonization and whatnot. So these are very interesting, even anthropological, historical questions that we can ask. But at the same time, I realized that food and beverages company would like to learn from this in terms of what are the kind of preferences that different populations have so as to leverage their food products accordingly. Well, that was an interesting way I realized that can be commercialized also. And of course, it has got huge consequences to public health. I repeat that all the recipes that I'm mentioning here, whatever is the number, 1 lakh, 160,000 odd or 10 lakh for that matter, all are consumed on a day-to-day basis by the people across the world, leading to eventual health consequences. Very exciting question that I'm dealing for the last 1 year and haven't solved it yet, but we do have some preliminary result, is that of having got this data of cuisines, which are, in my opinion, living things. These are cultural living entities. By the paradigm of cultural evolution, can I look at food and cuisines from a Darwinian perspective to see how they have evolved, how they have moved on from generation to generation and have diversified like other cultural entities such as languages, thereby leading to a beautiful tree out of it? Well, this is a very preliminary result, but a beautiful tree that we are in the process of building of the World Culinary Heritage. The thing that we can do, having got such a large amount of data, structured data of recipes as opposed to those which are available on YouTube and online repertoires, where you have the name, geocultural coordinate, ingredients very cleanly mapped to a specific name, its natural scientific name, natural species, flavor molecules, etc., we can start asking interesting questions. Typical recipe is of the size of 10 ingredients, and there are of the order of minimally around 1,000 ingredients that are available for us to be used. If I were to permutation and combination, if I were to make of these ingredients, I will end up getting these many recipes, which is more than the number of the stars in the whole universe. And this is pretty interesting for me to look at it because I started my journey as an aspiring astronomer. I did my thesis in astronomy to begin with, in IUCA. Well, what we are trying to do is use computational algorithms to hopefully design novel recipes. So we are writing novel recipe generation algorithms, right, which can hopefully go to a level where we can conduct a Turing test for chef, right? Is it possible to fool a chef by showing a real recipe, which the chef would obviously would recognize with his or her expertise, and at the same time showing up a recipe which is cooked by a computer, synthesized, and see whether we can fool him or her? I am not ambitious enough to say that right now these recipes will be cookable and palatable, but definitely we want to play this game on computers to begin with, all right? I don't know how many of you have seen Ratatouille, but that's the direction we are trying to move into. Chef Gustave says in Ratatouille that anybody can cook. So can computers cook is the question that we are asking with the data that is available. What's the idea behind it towards the public health direction? Can we make recipes such that they are better for health? Can we do interventions which are well-known, first of all, such as that of reduction of salt, fat, and sugar? At the same time, can we thereby add and remove ingredient and ingredient combinations in a manner that recipes have a pattern, culinary fingerprints, which are acceptable for that culture, thereby hopefully creating, or rather mining these galaxies to identify specific stars which are fitting into the popular culture? I hope, I'm sure that you would appreciate that if you belong to a specific culture like Tamilian, Andhrite, Punjabi, etc., you would be happier if a recipe is cooked, made healthier by the prescriptions of the whatever is used for making it healthier, but at the same time, falling into the pattern of your cuisine that you like. Okay, that's what we are trying to do. The last bit that we are working on is that of health. We realized that the literature, scientific literature, is straddled with a lot of contradictory claims that are being made and over time changing. For example, the egg, wine, and whatnot, they have been having prescriptions of drinking and not drinking on a timely basis. It keeps on changing. And my perception of this is that, well, again, complex systems. We are dealing with one complex entity, very complex entity, human body, and another complex entity called food itself, which are interacting with each other, giving rise to health consequences. I wish the relationship was as simple as this algebraic equation. It isn't. The idea is, then how do we do that? In 21st century, for the moment, I'm taking a recourse of data-driven analysis, collecting enough amount of data and trying to investigate it from the from a data-driven perspective. Now, one of the things that we looked at is to compile all literature that has been published so far available on Medline by building natural language processing protocols and named entity recognitions, correctly identifying a food entity mentioned in a sentence written in an abstract, also a disease entity, a medical subject heading, MeSH terminology, which is mentioned in the sentence. Second, the sentence, if it mentions a relationship between the two, that of one being good or bad for other, identifying that relationship, training, labeling a lot of data, training the algorithm, achieving the state of the art to the tune of 88% accuracy or so, including F1 score, etc., and then predicting the relationship for the rest of the literature. So we did it for around 38,000 research articles, exhaustively compiled from Medline, abstracts only, not full papers, and did this labeling, and we have got this data now. One of the conclusions, and one of the very interesting questions that we looked at and got to some interesting conclusion, is that of spices. So this has been a known question about why cultures across the world tend to use herbs and spices in their recipes. And the proximate answer for that is because of the flavor and fragrance. One of the ultimate answer around 1998 and 99 was obtained for the first time and has been reinforced over time is that herbs and spices are used also because they have antimicrobial properties, right? When we looked at the literature, we figured out that it's not only antimicrobial properties, but herbs and spices actually have a broad spectrum. If you look at the medical subject heading and a category of diseases, cardiovascular, metabolic, etc., diseases, turns out that herbs and spices tend to have far broader positive, benevolent effects on these diseases as opposed to having adverse effects. So we quantified it in a very simple manner to figure out what might be the role of herbs and spices, and we find that indeed that's a paper that is published. You might want to look at the paper that that's there, where we are on the data basis of the data, we are showing that probably the utility of the herbs and spices across cultures has persisted, partly also because of the appreciated benevolent effects of it. Probably, obviously not at the quantifiable level the way we are doing it now, but they probably understood based on the ethnic practices and have followed it on. What we have done now is, of course, going beyond herbs and spices. We have a repertoire of now around 2,200 ingredients belonging to around 25, 27 categories and their disease associations as obtained from the literature. And we know the literature is noisy. It can be even driven by some inherent benefits in terms of, if you know that herbs and spices are good for cardiovascular disorders, you would like to find out the beneficial effect in something else also. So we know that there is a noise in it. We're trying to clean the data, but we have created this repertoire called DietRx. We have also compiled from external resources the chemicals which are reported from these plant as well as animal food ingredients and possible connections with genes, all of these from empirical literature, barring this link, which we do not have, that of gene being directly linked with food per se. That's a putative link. We do not have it fully. So this is the repertoire we have created, and we are using variety of data analytic techniques, machine learning techniques, network models. Notice we can actually build a bipartite network of food and diseases and actually ask this question about, are there clusters of foods and disease terms which have predominantly positive associations and minimized for negative associations, hopefully thereby coming up with dietary intervention strategies where we can suggest that, okay, these are the food ingredients that are potentially far more beneficial for certain disease terms or coming from certain disease categories such as cancers of all type as well as diabetes and metabolic disorders. Can we find out ingredients that are predominantly beneficial? So those are the kind of questions that we are asking, and we do have some preliminary results unpublished yet. But we have some broad understanding of which these are all categories of ingredients, incidentally, which of them tend to be more on the positive and which of them are on the negative side in terms of they being generally helpful, benevolent, or those having slightly adverse effects. So we have done that. And the last thing that we are working on now, essentially this whole work is moving in the direction of looking at molecular level, at the level of recipes, ingredient level, looking at health effects, and in a manner that we can create a framework of computational gastronomy, which can be used for A, making food tastier as well as healthier. RecipeDB is the new work which is under progress, but I am presenting to this audience as having released it only 2 days back, under review at the moment, of recipes across the world and variety of coordinates of these. It's a network, if you wish, of categories, ingredient being related to. It's a multipartite network, multi-layer network, associated by virtue of shared molecules, shared recipes, and health effects, etc. Far complex data connecting aspect of recipe and ingredients, what quantity. Earlier, remember I had made a spherical cow assumption, no more a spherical cow. So we are looking at the progression of time, what is the ingredient that is coming first and then later, what are the quantity, unit, state, temperature, is it dry and fresh, what is the size, chunk size, which is being used of the ingredient. What category does it belong to? What kind of dietary style does it follow? Is it a keto recipe? Is it a vegan recipe, etc.? All of these connected to the USDA nutritional data, as well as other databases that we have internally, FlavorDB, DietRx, etc., creating a huge repertoire where we can possibly look for solutions coming out of food beneficial against various health-related issues, diet-linked diseases, largely. I believe all of this is taking us into a direction where we can seek for solutions which will lead us to a situation of personalized nutrition. Dietary advisories which are typically given are rather generic, in my opinion, and therefore are not well placed, right? Something being good or bad in general for people is not going to work. We need to look at levels at which we can go down to the level of each recipe and look at specific health effect. In this case, this particular landmark paper from Cell looked at postprandial glucose level specifically and came up with interesting conclusions that you cannot give broad advisory of eat or don't eat some recipe to all population, because variability is way too high in postprandial glucose level, given the same diet being given to a large number of people. 800 cohort size is what was taken here. And secondly, by compiling a large data, you can actually build a machine learning model which acts as a predictor based on a variety of features such as those here, including gut microbiome and other important factors that could be potentially related to the increase in postprandial glucose level, such that you can accurately predict this compared to standard available model, which is completely based on nutrition value. So fantastic experiment. And in my opinion, this kind of studies need to be replicated across different cultures, because eventually the dietary advices will be specific to your cuisine, not of something which you don't like or wouldn't like to eat. So there is a gamut of things that we are working on this space now. Of the interest of this particular audience and meeting is that of diet design, dietary interventions, which is what we are looking at, which is what I have told you how we are doing it at different levels. But also, we are looking at associated related interesting problem, that of novel recipe design, food beverage pairing, prediction of taste and odor based on the molecular properties, and importantly, in a longer run, we're trying to look for ways by which we can bring in sustainable food innovations. Recipes, how can we revive the older recipes, probably? How can you use ingredients that are edible but are not anymore incorporated into the recipes because of variety of reasons, right? So can we bring up that revolution? And in a country like India, this work has immense potential because of the cultural practices that are already locked in, except that they are getting lost over a period of time. So can we bring that back? These are the direction that we are working on right now. Having told you that I started my journey as a physicist and I was an aspiring astronomer, and I worked in IUCA, it was interesting for me to notice, recall after a decade or so of being worked there, a couple of decades now, that this was an interesting quote hanging in the kitchen of IUCA, that of the discovery of a new dish confers more happiness on humanity than the discovery of a new star. So incidentally, I have not been in the trajectory where I could discover new stars, but I hope I would be able to discover new dishes to make humanity healthier and happier, hopefully. Well, I would like to thank a lot of students who have worked with me. Again, an interesting fact is that I've not received any specific funding. This has been all curiosity-driven work, heavily. But now we are getting into a shape where we can demand funds based on the work that we have developed already. And a lot of undergrad students, postgrad students, PhD students have contributed to this. Very bright young students who had very good handle and wanted to ask interesting questions coming to our lab. My PhD students who have graduated now, 5 of them, MTech students, BTech students, and every summer I conduct in my lab a summer internship program, a large number of applications to the tune of 600, 800, of which eventually 10 or 12 end up working with me. And these are all students that have worked with me. This is the latest batch right now working in the lab, deploying Recipe DB and various aspects of it. As you can see, my average age of the lab is very low. I'm the only outlier here. And the last note at that I would say is that we do have PhD opportunities on various aspects of machine learning, data analytics, text mining, natural language processing, and as well as summer internship and various projects. So please spread the word and do let me know your comments even later on, and any suggestions that you may have in terms of which way this work can be grown in various directions, including that of public health, which you guys are expert in that. So thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.